In the middle of a storm, louder and louder, you gotta hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Oh, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
That right now. Let's raise a hallelujah to him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you today. We thank you today for your presence here. We thank you for your power that's in our lives. Lord, we thank you. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah today. Lord, in the midst of our trials, in the midst of our tests, in the midst of tribulation, Lord God, we raise a hallelujah to you. Oh God, there is nothing that can stop the church of God. Oh, the church that you have established, the church that you have put into place. God, the gates of hell cannot prevail. And Lord, we thank you for that today. We raise our hallelujah to you. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. Hallelujah, Father. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Lord, we're just asking you right now that you will just touch each one. God, every family, every home, every individual, Lord God, that's been struggling with sickness or God just needs a touch from you today. God, I'm asking you to do it in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that you are our healer, you are our deliverer, you are our hope, you are our joy. God, you are all those things and more. And God, we're just grateful today to be in the presence of our Almighty God today. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you now. Just lead and guide this service according to your spirit, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. Amen. Hard to stop after something like that, isn't it? Amen. We welcome you here to Grace Point today. We're glad to have all of you here. It seems like more and more are coming back. We've had, this COVID has really been a tough thing over December and January, but praise the Lord. I think we're through it. Amen? And I'm believing God for us to just see everybody getting back soon and being a part of the services, and we just want you to know we love you. If you're not able to be here, we understand, and we're praying for you and asking God to do something in your life to bring healing. Amen. Well, we want to remind you about our Next Steps classes that will be right after the service. If you'll meet at the back in the Welcome Center, in the back of the sanctuary after the service, someone will greet you there and get you to our Next Steps classes. We want you to be a part of those if you can today. If you're new, especially because then you find out a little bit more about our church and what we believe and get to know some of the pastoral staff. And so we would love to have you come to our Next Steps classes. They'll provide a meal for you. And so you just have to go back to the Welcome Center and they'll get that taken care of. Then our winter semester small groups are going and going strong. We want you to be a part of those. If you haven't started in one yet, join in one. We've got several going on. I know we were a little late on our dinner club groups, getting those established, but now we have them established. There's leaders out there that should be contacting you if you signed up to be part of the dinner club. If you didn't sign up yet and want to still get involved, see Miss Janice. She'll get you signed up and involved in the dinner club, but That's a time where we just get together with friends from here in the church and go to dinner somewhere or at somebody's home and just have some fellowship. Amen? And that's a great small group to be involved in to get to know some people. Last night we had a great Valentine's banquet. Yeah, it was awesome. We had some good food and some good games. Learned a lot about some of the newlyweds and soon-to-be newlyweds, and they didn't win, so, you know, but they're working on it. They're going to be working on it, right? Next year, you got it, right? but we had a good time and just a great time of fellowship together as couples, and we watched the series, the first one in a series on Right Now Media called The Crazy Cycle. I want to encourage you, if you weren't able to be there last night, but you want to help your marriage, go and watch this series, okay? Right Now Media, it's free to anybody in this church to go and download the app. You can watch it on, like a Roku TV or, you can do it on a tablet. You can do it on your phone. Wherever you are, you can have Right Now Media. All I have to have is your email address to get you signed up for it. And then you can go in and you can watch this series, The Crazy Cycle. And it's just great for marriages to help, get you out of that, crazy cycle of hurting one another and somebody stepping off and making it right, okay? And that's what it's really all about. And so we want you to be a part of that. If you haven't paid for last night, please do so today. We still have the app up to where you can do that on the app, or you can put it in the offering today. But we had a great time, amen, and looking forward to it again next year as we build upon this. Wanted to remind you that Throw Down the Gauntlet game night is Saturday, February the 19th, this coming Saturday here at the church, and so if you haven't signed up for that, please go on the app, sign up for that, come, and let's play some games together and hang out. Then the men's bowling night is Friday, February the 25th. And the ladies' craft night will also be that night, Friday, February the 25th. So all those can be signed up on the app. So if you don't have the app, come to one of us, staff, one of the leaders here, and they will help you get that signed up on your phone so that you can sign up for these different events. Also, Sunday, February the 27th, will be Women's Ministry Day. And my wife will be speaking in the morning service. You don't want to miss that. And then that evening at 5 o'clock, we're going to come back for an annual business meeting in the fellowship hall at 5 o'clock in that afternoon in the fellowship hall. We'll have our annual business meeting. We'll have a meal for you provided. And so we want you to come and just be a part of that and find out all the great things that are going on here at Grace Point, what we've done in the past year and what we're looking forward to doing in 2022. And so we want to take time to spend just telling you all those great things during our annual business meeting. It's time for us to receive our morning tithes and offerings. Let's give God praise for that this morning. Amen. I'll tell you, this church is a giving church. We've had a rough January as far as, people being able to be here, but yet God's providing. Amen. And He always provides, but it's through our faithfulness. It's through us faithfully giving of our tithes and offerings to Him that He's able to meet every need of this church. Let's pray. Father, we thank You so much for what You have given to us. And so, Lord, we come with our offerings, our tithes today, and we present them in worship to You. God, we give them not so that the church can have something, but God, so Your kingdom can be furthered here on this earth, God, through this in our obedience to giving to You. Now, we love You and thank You for all that You give to us now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you give this morning as the ushers are coming by. You can go ahead and stand up here in just a minute. We're going to have a time of fellowship together, 5 minutes that you've got to just go and shake hands and hug on some necks and just let everybody know that you love them. So let's have a time of fellowship today. Who am I that?
the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Sing it out to him. Oh, there's nothing. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. And I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountains is the God of the valleys, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me yet. Nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only turn praise into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn morning. You turn morning to dancing. You turn beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. Gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only. nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Lord, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Song we could ever see, worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, Jesus the name.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Every song, worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Make that your prayer, church. We live for you, Jesus the name. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Wonder and show.
none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Goodness of God. All my life you have been there.
Father, today I just want to speak of the goodness of God. God, as the song says, all the days of my life, you have been so, so faithful, so good. God, I thank you. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your mercies. I thank you for your grace today for my life. God, without that, I wouldn't make it. Without that, I wouldn't have any hope. Without that, there is nothing that I could look forward to in life, because, God, it's your goodness, it's your mercy, it's your grace, Lord God, that carries me through from day to day. God, as I make mistakes, as I fail, as I fall, as I don't do everything I'm supposed to do, God, you are there, God, always with me, faithfully, sir, just by my side, just helping me and strengthening me, God, I thank you. God, for your goodness today. Oh, your goodness to me, that you see all my faults. You see everything that I fail in, but God, you love me anyway. Oh, God, the goodness of God. Oh, we just thank you today. We thank you today that you are faithful to heal. God, we are thankful today that you are faithful to God, restore relationships that have been broken, God. I thank you today that you're able to, God, repair marriages, and God, bring them back together. God, those that have been struggling, Lord, I'm praying right now, God, that you will bring them together, God, in the goodness of God, in the goodness of God. God, that they would get focused on the goodness of God in their lives and realize it's not all for nothing, God, that they do have something to look forward to. God, that your presence in their marriage, in their home, in their family is worth it, God. Oh, to just carry on, to be faithful to you, Lord God, in all the things that you've been faithful to them in. Oh, God, we're just asking you now, God, to just touch homes and families and relationships right now. God, I know finances can be difficult. I pray for financial miracles right now in Jesus' name, in homes. God, as they begin to turn their money back over to you, as they begin to tithe and give offerings and turn it into your hands, Lord God, and they do this with an expectation that, God, that you will be there and you will meet every need. God, I know that you will, because you've done it in my life. Because, God, you've been so, so good all the days of my life. Oh, Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for what you're doing right here, right now, in this service, Lord. Just begin to do something new in hearts, Lord God, in lives. God, let us know what our purpose is. God, why you have established us, why you have set us apart for your purposes, Lord God, and what that purpose is, so that we can follow you and do your will. Lord, we just thank you for all that you're doing already, and God, just continue to work now through the word into our lives, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Amen. That song gets me every time. I guess it's the older I get, the more I think that song applies to me, because it's all the days of my life, he's been so, so good. I just want to declare it. I want to proclaim how good he is to people. Because if people just realized how good he is, they would want to serve him. They would want to be a part of this Christian faith. They would want him in their life. Man, we got to display the goodness of God. Amen? So that people want it and desire it. Hallelujah. Well, today I want to continue a series that we started last week, and we're just looking basically at our vision statement that God had given us back a number of years ago now, and It's summed up in three basic parts in our vision statement. But the vision statement is leading people to know God, find purpose, and make a difference as fully devoted followers of Christ. Now, we talked about the fact that we want everyone who walks through these doors to know God. Amen. That's our purpose. That's why we're here. That is our main focus, is to make sure that everybody who walks through these doors knows God. But it doesn't stop there. Each of us as followers of Christ must have a passion for the lost like Jesus did. We must do as Paul told Timothy, to be doing the work of an evangelist. He didn't tell him to become an evangelist and go out on the road and sell everything and go and do. No, he said, Timothy, as a pastor of this church, do the work of an evangelist. And so each of us are called to do this work. No matter what our vocation is, we are to do the work of an evangelist. We are to go out and proclaim the good news to everyone that we meet and come in contact with. So that's our first purpose. That is the first thing that God has established us to do as a church, is to help people to know God. The second thing is to find purpose. So today we want to focus on this second part of our vision statement, finding purpose. God has given each of us a purpose in life. He created us for a unique and specific purpose. Now I want you to hear that. A unique and specific purpose. We're supposed to be doing what He has created us to do. How many of you know none of us are the same? None of us in this room are the same. You know, they do fingerprints. Every fingerprint is different. There's things now with the iris of the eye. There's things with, all kinds of different things. You know, right now you can't even get into a phone without a thumbprint almost, you know, or a facial recognition, because everybody's face is different. Everybody's fingerprint is different. So they use these things because all of us are unique. And sometimes I think we get lost in this and we think we're all the same. And we think, well, I should have the purpose that they have, because I like their purpose. I don't really like what my purpose has been. I want to do what they do. And we've got to come to a place where we realize that God created us and made us special for a specific, if I can say it right, I almost didn't get it out there, specific purpose in our lives. So at Grace Point, we want to help every individual discover that what their purpose is. And as we will talk about next week, then help them to use that purpose to make a difference. Use that purpose to make a difference. So first of all, I need to make sure that you believe that God does have a specific purpose for your life and that you are uniquely made. So I want to read in Psalm 139, verses 13 and 14. Psalm 139, verses 13 and 14. It says, "For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well." God never created an accident. He's never made a mistake. So if you think that you are a mistake, or you're all messed up and you're not worthy and you're not able and you're not this or that, get it out of your mind. Get it out of your heart right now. God never made a mistake. And He created you for a specific purpose. He has a plan for your life. He knit you together in your mother's womb, it says. And He did. Wonderful are His works. Wonderful. You are wonderful. You were formed by God in your mother's womb, created by a wonderful God for amazing things. We just have to discover them and then submit to His will for our lives to realize them. That's what it takes. We need to realize God knows what He's doing better than we do. Come on now. God knows better what he's doing than we do. We just got to submit to his will. You see, he has plans for us. Jeremiah 29:11 says it. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil. To give you a future and a hope. That's what God has planned for us. He has plans, great plans for us. And this says, declares the Lord. He's shouting it. He's saying, listen, I have a plan for you. And it's for welfare and not for evil. To give you a future and a hope, I have a plan for you. Then Isaiah 14:24 says, and the Lord of hosts has sworn, as I have planned, so shall it be. And as I have purposed, so shall it stand. I want you to understand, God has a plan, and it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Sometimes we can fight it. We can run from it. We can be like Jonah, and God tells him to go to Nineveh, and he goes the opposite direction. But where did Jonah end up? He ended up in Nineveh, but through the belly of a whale. I mean, we don't want that. We don't want to go in the opposite direction of what God is calling us. We want to do what God is calling us, because when we do, we fulfill our purpose in life. Jonah was supposed to go to Nineveh to preach the gospel so that people would get saved. And they ended up, the whole town turned to God. And then he got mad about it. He didn't like his purpose. And so many of us sometimes can get upset with what our purpose is. Well, I don't like my purpose. He didn't want the Ninevites to get saved. He didn't want God to show favor on them. He didn't want them to be blessed by God, because they were mean people. They had been killing and persecuting his people for a long time. And he was like, God, I don't want to go over there and let them get all your blessings. I know what you're going to do. You're going to forgive them. And I don't want you to do that. So I'm going to go over here. But folks, we need to understand, God's purpose will take place. Sometimes he will use us to fulfill that purpose, but if we rebel enough, he'll end up using somebody else to fulfill the purpose. So let me ask you, do you believe that God has good plans and purposes prepared for you? He made you for that specific purpose, and he wants you to fulfill it. In our Next Steps classes, we administer what is called a gifts test. It's not really a test. It's more of a tool that we use to help you to evaluate what your specific gifts are, what God has created you for. It helps to just identify some of these, but all of them are based on some scriptures that I want to read to you right now, because I want you to understand, God has put gifts in each one of us, and he's given gifts to the church, and he wants us to fulfill what the gifts and talents and abilities are that he has given you in the church, so that the church can be edified. Romans 12:6-8 says, in his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. And I'm reading now the New Living Translation, okay? So, in his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. So that's in Romans 12 where Paul is instructing the Romans. Then we switch over, Paul, to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 12, 14 through 11 in the New Living Translation. He says there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. There are different kinds of service, but we serve the same Lord. God works in different ways, but it is the same God who does the work in all of us. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. To one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. To another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. The same Spirit gives great faith to another. And to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. He gives one person the power to perform miracles and another the ability to prophesy. He gives someone else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still another person is given the ability to speak in an unknown language, while others are still given the ability to interpret what is being said. It is the one and only Spirit who distributes all these gifts. And He alone, do you hear this? He alone decides which gift each person should have. And so we hear clearly through Paul's teaching that we are all gifted by God through the Holy Spirit for certain things. We shouldn't desire to have the gifts that Janice has. We shouldn't desire to have the gifts that Jeff Burkhart has. Although I wish I could do woodworking like him. But there's gifts that he has and abilities of serving and giving and doing that I don't have. And he's needed in the body. You see, all of us are given gifts by the Holy Spirit, and we shouldn't say, well, my gift isn't good enough, and my gift isn't as good as so-and-so, and I can't do my gift because whatever. One more scripture, 1 Corinthians 12, 27 through 31. 1 Corinthians 12, 27 through 31 in New Living, it says, all of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of it. Here are some of the parts God has appointed for the church. First, apostles. Second, are prophets. Third, are teachers. Then those who do miracles, those who have the gift of healing, those who can help others, those who have the gift of leadership, those who speak in unknown languages. Are we all apostles? Are we all prophets? Are we all teachers? Do we all have the powers to do miracles? Do we all have the gift of healing? Do we all have the ability to speak in unknown languages? Do we all have the ability to interpret unknown languages? Of course not. So you should earnestly desire the most helpful gifts. But now I let me show you a way of life that is best of all. And he goes right into 1 Corinthians chapter 13, talking about love. You see, we're all given these gifts, and we're all supposed to function in the body, but we can't do what somebody else is doing. God has called us for what we need to do, and then we need to love one another in the midst of all of this. Ephesians 4, 11 through 12 is the last scripture on this. It says, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do the work and build up the church, the body of Christ. There are some that are called, like myself, to be pastors and teachers and leaders that are to build you up to go and do the work of the ministry. And so that's what my function is in the church. But what is your function? What is it God has called you to do? God created each of us with different gifts and passions. We've already talked about this. Paul, in his teaching, made it clear to us that everyone is created for a different purpose. Now, we just have to find what our gift or purpose is and start doing it or start using it. None are greater than the other. For if God created you for that purpose, then what could be a greater gift? What could be a better, greater purpose? If God created you for that purpose, then how could some other purpose be greater than what He's given you? And so we need to understand there aren't greater gifts, but when Paul in some translations says the greater gifts, he is really talking about desiring gifts that are the most helpful to the body of Christ. He's saying, you know, yeah, desire the greater gifts, which are those that really edify the body. But there are so many different ones of those. And so we just need to have the gifts. God, give me a gift that's going to build up the body. That's what he's saying. Whatever the gifts the Holy Spirit has given to you will be the most helpful to the body if you just function in it. If you identify it and begin to function in it. And that's the hard part sometimes, is to identify. To identify what the gifts are. And that's why we do this in our Next Steps classes, is to help you to find that gifts. If you've been here, a member for a long time, you haven't done the gifts test, get with me. I'll give you the gifts test, and we'll take you through it so that you can find that purpose, so you can get involved in areas where maybe you haven't gotten involved before because you just didn't really know what your giftings were. There is a list that they have, but let me just tell you something. This isn't all-inclusive. Because there are so many other gifts that you can't write them all down. These are kind of like general categories, but there's administration, there's apostleship, there's craftsmanship, there's discernment, there's evangelism, exhortation, faith, giving, healing, helps, hospitality, intercession, knowledge, leadership, mercy. Is not my gifting. Mercy is a gift that some people have. It's just a gift that they have to be able to just mercifully grab hold of somebody, just hug on them and love them, and they everything's all right. Their mercy is their gift. Miracles, missionary, music, worship, pastor and shepherd, prophecy, service, teaching, tongues and interpretation of tongues and wisdom. All of these are the ones that are on the gifts test that we administer to help you to find, but they're just like I said, general categories. There are so many other things that you could be gifted at and talented at that we can't put down on paper because there's just too many. We are all so uniquely made that every person can have a little bit different combination of any one of these in their life, and it's totally a different purpose. So part of this process is discovering your purpose, is asking God to give you a revelation of these specific gifts in your life. And that's what's so important. I can't tell you what your gift is. Now, I can go through this evaluation. We can kind of give you an idea, but God needs to reveal to you what your gift is. God needs to speak to you and tell you, this is what I've called you to do. This is my purpose for you. This is what I have created you for. Because God created each of us with different gifts and passions, but then God has given each of us different life experiences. How many of you know you haven't gone through what I've gone through? I've heard pastors share, you know, there's a lot of people that want to be in leadership, and they ask, you know, hey, can I be like you? I want to be like you. Will you pray that I'll be like you? And they're like, do you really want to go through all I went through? Do you really want to endure all the hardships, all the things, all the tests and trials that I've been through to get to where I am? And they'll be like, whoa, wait a minute, maybe I don't. You know? I mean, because each one of us have life experiences that bring us to a place where we are fulfilling our purpose. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4 says, "All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. Because when I have gone through all of my trials, then I can comfort others." And then Romans 12:1 says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." As I've said, my experiences are different than yours, and these different experiences also form our purpose in life. Before I lost my dad in a car accident, I couldn't relate to someone who had lost a parent early in life. I couldn't. But now I can. If you lose somebody unexpectedly, I can be there and really be able to bring comfort and hope and help in those situations. Because I know what it's like to be here on a Wednesday night and get a phone call. And it's my sister telling me that the police had called her and he was in a car accident and died. I can remember having to go in and get my mom out of the class and to tell her that my dad had died. And all the things that we had to do because we were down here in Tennessee and he was in Wisconsin. And to get together and to go and all those different things. Those are things that you can't be able to help somebody else through until you've been through it. And you can do your best, but you can't relate the way that you can once you've been through it. And so I find my purpose through being able to help others, to care for others, to show that mercy that isn't natural for me to other people because of what I've been through. You understand? I mean, it changes your whole purpose. It changes everything in you. What I'm trying to say is we are all called to offer our lives as living, holy sacrifices to God in every way. In everything that I have done, everything I've gone through, I now can just offer myself to God as a living sacrifice. God, use me. Use me how you want to help others. And this means not only do I submit my spirit to the Lord for his purposes, but my body and soul as well. Every part of me to offer it to him. Say, God, use me for your purposes. God wants to use all of these to help others and to minister to them. That's what the goal is. We don't go through trials just to go through trials in this life. It's not because God's mean. It's not because he just wants us to have tough times and do things. I mean, you know, Dan and Stacy, you guys are going through something in your lives that can help other people so much. To be able to see that you have faith in God all the way through this, that you guys have been able to stay together in marriage through all of this, that you guys have been able to endure the hardships and the difficulties through all of this. God can use you guys in such a great way to people. And you don't even know how many people you have touched already because of what God has allowed you to go through. But it's for a purpose. It's for a purpose. It's not for nothing. It's not just because God just wanted them to suffer. It's so that there's a purpose that they can edify the body. I mean, it encouraged me every time I see you guys. It does. It just lifts me up and goes, man, I could make it. What am I going through? You know? I mean, we love you guys. And we celebrate the purpose that God has for you guys in this fellowship. And I could point to many others in this fellowship and say, you've gone through these tough times for a purpose. For a purpose. so that God can use you to comfort and edify and lift up and encourage others. God has great plans for every one of you. Every one of you. Sometimes, though, we allow the enemy to tell us that we have made too many mistakes or are too messed up to help anyone else. But you must remember the scripture in Luke 1:37 says, "For nothing will be impossible with God." Nothing will be impossible with God. So if you're sitting there saying, "Man, I'm just too messed up. I've done too many wrong things. I've done too much stuff that I can't help anybody else." It's not. God can do anything. And if you don't believe me, then look at the life of Paul the Apostle. If there was ever a person that could try to say that he had done too much and couldn't fulfill God's purpose in his life, it was Paul. Because when you look in 1 Timothy 1:12 through 17, he kind of gives a little outline of some of his life. He says, "I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength to do this work. He considered me trustworthy and appointed me to serve him, even though I used to blaspheme the name of Christ." Now, how many of you can say, "I've gone out and I blasphemed the name of Christ? I went out saying Jesus is not real. This is a cult. This is not right, and I am against it. And if you say that you're for it, then I'm going to take you to jail." Not too many of us have done that. But Paul, he did. It says, "Even though I used to blaspheme the name of Christ, in my insolence, I persecuted his people. But God had mercy on me because I did it in ignorance and unbelief. Oh, how generous and gracious our Lord was. He filled me with the faith and love that come from Christ Jesus. This is a testimony saying, trustworthy saying, and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all. But God had mercy on me so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of his great patience with even the worst sinners. Then others will realize that they too can believe in him and receive eternal life. All honor and glory to God forever and ever. He is the eternal King, the unseen one who never dies. He alone is God. Amen." This is Paul's testimony. So please, please don't tell me that God can't use you for whatever reason. If Paul can stand there and say, "I did all these things. I took Christians before the courts who were then condemned to death. I stood there and held the coats of those who stoned Stephen. I was there. I went after the Christians. And yet God showed grace to me. God showed mercy to me." If he can do that for Paul, he can do it for you. Paul had the best reason in the world to say he couldn't fulfill God's purpose. He was the worst sinner, yet God redeemed him and gave him a purpose to fulfill. And what a purpose. Paul started more churches than anyone else in the New Testament time period. Paul wrote more letters that became Holy Scripture than anyone else. Paul won more Gentiles to Christ than anyone else. Paul discipled and trained more ministers of the gospel than anyone else. Paul had a purpose and followed God to use and allowed God to use him to fulfill that purpose. So you can too.
You can too. He can use you. I don't care where you've come from. I don't care what you've done in your past. I don't care about those things because God doesn't care. When you accepted Him as Lord and Savior, all that was gone. He said, behold, you're a new creation. All things have passed away. So he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. When we bring up an excuse of, well, I can't because of this, he's like, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? I forgave you of that. It's gone. What are you talking about? We're the ones that remember it. We're the ones that bring it up. We're the ones that think, you know, make it to where we can't because we don't want to. So I ask you today, do you know your purpose? Do you know what God has called you to do? Do you know what He wants you, what He created you and placed you in the church for this moment in time for? Do you know that? Or are you going through life without purpose and just trying to make it from day to day with little to no direction? That's the question I got for you today. God wants to reveal a purpose and plan to you today that He has made for you. That He has made for you. That you were born for. And if you don't know that, then what we have to do is we have to seek God for that. Because like I said earlier, He has to reveal it to you. It has to be a revelation from Him. And we think of that big word, oh, it's a revelation. That's only what apostles get. No. Revelation is God just pulling back the blinders and showing you things in your life. That's revelation. And He wants to give you a revelation in your life of what your purpose and what your plan is. He wants to reveal to you who He created you to be. So I'm going to ask Josh if you'll come up and come and begin to play. And I'm going to go into a time where I feel like we're supposed to pray and in just a moment. Because I believe God wants to give you what your purpose is and what your plan is, what He has planned for you, because it's good. It's good. I know we can look at Dan and Stacy and say, well, that's not good. It's good because God puts you there and God's taking you through it and God's using you for a great purpose. And we can try to say, well, Paul's purpose wasn't that good. He ended up in prison. But that's where he wrote most of the epistles that we read now. Most of the things that I referred to today were written while Paul was in prison. We think, man, that's not a good purpose. Oh, yeah, it was a great purpose. Because it got Paul in a place where he would sit and he would write and he would meditate and he would know what God wanted to say and pen it for us. I'm going to have us go to prayer in just a moment. Ruth, if you want to come, I think she has something that God laid on her heart to share.
Good morning. God gave me a word of wisdom. Well, actually, He gave it to me yesterday, and then during the sermon, my heart started to pound faster, and I recognized that the Holy Spirit wanted me to share this word of wisdom with you. It's out of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. If you know your Bible, just remember Gideon. He was the smallest. The widow, her oil didn't run out. And she only had a little bit. Don't despise the gift that you've been given by Him. You may think, it's such a little gift. Don't compare it with the gifts of others. Think about the boy who brought his little fish and his little bread. We know all the stories. Don't think of yourself as small. Even it says here the world will think of you as small. Expect that. But He who is within us is greater than he who is of this world. So remember, what the world sees as foolish, God is going to use. So can I translate that?
Okay.
Sometimes I tend to explain it, but they think of you as small. But that is exactly what God wants the world to think, so that He can do this miraculous, this great thing that he does so well through you, through the power of the Holy Spirit within you. And the Holy Spirit is faithful to develop that gift because He's your teacher. And He is connecting you to people, to teachers. If you are a prophet, but you're not very familiar with the gifts of the prophet, guess what? A prophet is about to show up in your life. Or vice versa. You are one. Guess what? The next generation of prophets are here. The next generation of apostles and teachers are here. God is faithful. So remember, what God chose, what is foolish in the world, He's to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen. The gifts. That's a gift that God has given to Ruth. Many of you may not know Ruth, but I've known Ruth for a long time, a lot of years, and God's gifted her in many areas. And when we're obedient to that gift, when we function in that gift, the body is edified. So I pray that word was an edification to you. I believe it was to me, and hopefully to all of you. That's what God does. He uses our gifts to edify the body. And your gift may not be that gift, okay? He may not be calling you to come up on the platform and say, you know, stand in front of everybody and talk, okay? So don't get scared. Don't be afraid to ask God, oh, God, what's my purpose? Because don't make it that, you know? No. He uses you the way He has created you for the purpose He has for you. And when you fulfill that purpose, it's going to be easy because it's like, okay, this is what I was made for. You know, it's not going to be a struggle. It's not going to be like, oh, don't make me get up there and do that. It's going to be like, okay, God, I'll go do that. But we've got to fulfill our purpose. So I want to take just a few moments in our service, and I'm going to ask you to stand with me and maybe come down to these altars and find a place, and let's just really ask God this morning, reveal to me my purpose. Now, God, I know some of it. I may know I've gotten some of this, but God, I really want to know what my purpose is. What is it you're wanting me to do now? What is it in my life that, you know, you've prepared me for through all the circumstances? Because sometimes our purposes can change in the time of life that we're in. And God says, okay, now I want to use you in this gifting that I had given you from your birth, but it was for this time, for this moment. So we need to find out what those are. And let's just take just a few moments as Josh leads and sings. Find a place of prayer, whether it's at these altars, right there at your chair, wherever. Find a place and let's ask God, what is my purpose? What am I supposed to be doing right now in Him? Let's find that place right now. Hallelujah.
Give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me.
Father, I'm just praying right now, God, that you would just bring this revelation to each one. God, what their purpose is in this season, in this moment of their life. God, that they could be that edification to the body that you have called them to be. God, there are so many gifts. There are so many different things. Lord God, I know what some of mine definitely aren't, but God, I know what some of them are. And I got to function in those gifts. And Lord, I pray that you would help me to function even better in the gifts that you have given to me. God, I want to do my best to fulfill your purpose and your plan in my life. God, help me to submit myself to you. God, to submit to your will, to your way and not my own. God, to not rely upon my own abilities and function, God, in what I think I should be doing, but God, in what you have called me to do, in your purpose for my life. Father, I'm asking you, God, to just help each one of us to find that place. God, to function in the body. Because God, you have called us, you have revealed yourself to us. We know God. And now, God, it's time for us to find that purpose. To find that purpose so that, as we're going to talk about next week, God, that we can make a difference. Make a difference in our world around us. Make a difference in this church. Make a difference for your kingdom's sake, oh God. Father, I just thank you for each one today. I pray your blessing upon them, Lord, as they go from this place. God, may they go still asking you, God, show me my purpose. Reveal it to me, continually revealing to me your purpose and plan for my life. And then, Lord, help me to fulfill it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. And I pray that God has spoken to you something clear and direct that you can begin to do. If there's something that I need to help you with, come and talk to me so that we can help you fulfill your purpose in the church. Amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon. Next steps, if you're going to go to next steps, if you can go back to the Welcome Center, we would love to have you join us for next steps today.